Dat is inmiddels nummer 1493 met een uitzending van vandaag 9 december 2018. Dit is het bulletin van zondag. This bulletin will be largely in English. Vandaag net als gisteren een ratje toe aan allerlei datamodus als test. Allemaal 1500 hertz en allemaal automatisch schakelend. Ja, en ik had eigenlijk een aflevering geschreven over de serie spionageverhalen om vandaag te gebruiken. Maar er waren twee ongelukken die dat in de weg zaten. Het eerste ongeluk was dat er iets misging met het programma met FLDigi om de data weg te schrijven naar schijf. Ik had een heel mooie samenstelling gemaakt van allemaal modus. Dat duurt net zo lang als dat het item duurt, zeg maar. En ja, toen ik klaar was, toen stond het dus niet op de schijf. Dus moest ik nog een keer. En daar ging een deel van de tijd op. Toen ik daarmee bezig was, toen was mijn goede vriend Roderickje. Je weet wel, dat rode gevaar op vier poten wat hier sinds een tijdje rondloopt. Die heeft al een tijdje de mode om alle etensbakjes en alle andere zaken, zelfs kledingstukken, naar beneden te mieteren van de bovenetage. Maar kennelijk was die daarmee klaar, want nu volgden er een paar niet al te zware meubelstukken. Het leek wel een oorlogsgebied. Allemaal beneden onderaan de trap. Echt niet te geloven, de herrie die dat gaf. Dus even goed oppassen dat we de boel vast gaan zetten. Ik heb een dubbelzijdig plakband al tevoorschijn gehaald. Goed, let op, maandag 10 december om ongeveer 13 uur 12 UTC, dat is 14:12 lokale tijd hier, is het weer mogelijk om met het ISS mee te luisteren. Het contact is op de bekende frequentie 145.800 en dat vindt plaats met Fox 5 Kilo Echo Mike in het Engels. En het tegenstation, dat is een Franse middelbare school in de plaats Thiviers, moet ik zeggen. Dus morgen 13 uur 12 UTC, 14 uur 12 lokale tijd op 145.800 het ISS. En het is al met een porto of met een scannertje te ontvangen.
This is ARRL Audio News, your weekly summary of news highlights from the world of amateur radio. If you retransmit audio news through a repeater, listen for the Morse code K character, followed by 4 seconds of silence. That's your cue to stop transmitting so that your repeater timer can reset.
I'm Carla Pereira, KC1HSX, and these are our stories for Friday, December 7th. ARRL has announced the winners of the 2018 QST Antenna Design Competition. Requirements for the competition included an antenna for one or more bands between 2200 meters and 10 meters that could fit within a 30 by 50 foot area and be no taller than 30 feet above ground at any point. The first prize winner was Steve Adler, VK5SFA, for his high power 160 and 80 meter transmitting magnetic loop antenna. Second prize went to Mike Sapp, WA3TTS, for his reversible U antenna. And the third prize was awarded to Joe Riesert, W1JR, for a stealthy 3/8 wavelength vertical antenna for 20 meters. There were a number of honorable mentions as well. The winning designs and the honorable mention designs will be published in 2019 issues of QST Magazine. Speaking of QST, the January issue will announce a new competition. This time, QST is inviting members to submit their best Morse key designs in the QST Key Competition. Design styles can include straight key, semi-automatic key or bug, paddle, or sideswiper. The deadline to submit entries is June 1st, 2019. Full details appear in the January issue. The FCC Enforcement Bureau has called upon marketers of light-emitting diode or LED signs to ensure that these lights comply with FCC rules. Since March of this year, the agency has entered into 21 settlement agreements with companies that marketed non-compliant LED signs in violation of the Communications Act and FCC rules. The settlements yielded approximately $850,000 in penalties and commitments to ensure compliance with the law going forward. Adherence to the FCC's equipment authorization and marketing rules is critical because radio frequency emissions from the signs may cause harmful interference to licensed communications. LED lights are often used in digital billboards and other commercial and industrial applications, including large video displays in sports arenas. Prior to being marketed in the U.S., LED sign models must be tested and comply with FCC technical standards and must include the proper labeling, identification, and user information disclosures. The ARRL International Grid Chase Certificates page is now live at igc.arrl.org/certificates.php. At year's end, International Grid Chase participants will have the option to generate a certificate based on year-end tallies. For now, participants can select a month, then select up to 16 band mode certificates they'd like to create. Participants with more than 16 band mode activities can choose to generate 2 certificates to encompass the excess, or can just generate certain band certificates, or just certain mode certificates, even just 1 band mode if desired. The Canadian National Parks on the Air event will get underway on January 1st, 2019 and continue until year's end. A volunteer group of a half dozen hams in Nova Scotia, working with a zero budget, came up with the notion of attempting to replicate the success of the ARRL National Parks on the Air event in 2016, first created to mark the centennial of the National Park Service. Radio Amateurs of Canada has announced its support for the event in cooperation with Parks Canada. All radio amateurs are invited to activate any of Park Canada's 48 national parks and 171 national historic sites while chasers attempt to land a contact. Activity for activators and chasers will be tracked on a dedicated website and a real-time leaderboard, and operators may compete for online awards and certificates. For updates on the program's progress, visit the Canadian National Parks on the Air website at cnpota.ca. In something new for the year 2019, the Society of Midwest Contesters has announced an expansion of the North American Collegiate Championship, which takes place in conjunction with the North American QSO Party, better known simply as the NAQP. In 2019, the championship will also cover the NAQP RIDI event. The National Contest Journal sponsors the North American QSO parties. The NAQP SSB runs from 1800 UTC on January 19th to 0600 UTC on January 20th, 2019. The NAQP RIDI runs 1800 UTC on February 23rd to 0600 UTC on February 24th. The exchange for the NAQPs is name and ARRL or RAC section, and participants may use any name associated with the school, which must remain the same for the entire event.
And now with this week's satellite update, here's Bruce Page, KK5DO.
We finally had Fox One Cliff launched. It was a little bit delayed and delayed, but on December 3rd, there was a successful launch. After launch and deployment of the satellite, it was not too much later that the satellite came alive. It was sending telemetry. Hams around the world collected the telemetry and uploaded it to the data warehouse to be analyzed. The first ham to receive telemetry data and send it to the warehouse was Burns, WB1FJ. Later, the satellite went into safe mode. During safe mode, Veronica transmits Fox One Cliff, safe mode. On December 5th, Drew, KO4MA, AMSAT Vice President of Operations and Oscar Number Administrator, bestowed upon Fox One Cliff the designation of AMSAT Oscar 95 or AO95. The satellite continues to go through commissioning checks and tests. Congratulations also to Jerry, N0JY, Vice President of Engineering, and his entire staff who worked on and made this satellite possible. This is Bruce Page, KK5DO, for the ARRL Audio News.
I'm Steve Ford, WB8IMY, and this is the ARRL Audio News Propagation Forecast for Friday, December 7th. Believe it or not, we have a sunspot. Actually, we have a group of sunspots. And unlike the previous spots, this one is a bit stronger and may produce a flare or two before it rotates out of view. In the meantime, the solar flux index has bounced up to 71. All this comes just in time for the ARRL 10-meter contest this weekend and may last well into next week. So it'll be very interesting to see how the upper HF bands behave. At the same time, there is a large coronal hole in the sun's atmosphere, and it's sending a stream of particles our way, as always. That's bad news for the 10-meter contest. However, it looks like the stream may not arrive until the contest is actually over. On VHF and UHF, be on the lookout for tropo band openings on 2 meters and up in Oklahoma, Kansas, and the Pacific Northwest.
And that concludes ARRL Audio News for this week. Our thanks to all contributors to this week's report. ARRL Audio News is produced by the American Radio Relay League, the National Association for Amateur Radio. For more information on amateur radio or the ARRL, visit us on the web at arrl.org. You can also find us on Facebook and Twitter by searching for ARRL. If you have a question or comment about ARRL Audio News, email us at audionews@arrl.org. This program is copyright ARRL, all rights reserved. 73, and thanks for listening.
I'm Ono of the Foundations of Amateur Radio podcast in Australia, and you're listening to the Daily Minutes by Papa Alpha Zero Echo Tango Echo. Foundations of Amateur Radio. The question that new amateurs most often ask after "what radio should I buy" is, "how do I get the best antenna?" In a household where you're the only antenna-affected aficionado, the question is likely more along the lines of, why do you need another antenna? The answer is pretty much the same. An antenna is fit for purpose, generally only one purpose. Going from A to B without walking might involve a car. If it's just you, one seat is enough. If your local cricket team is coming too, you might need more seats. If the road is rough, you might need a good suspension, and if it's the middle of summer in Australia, air conditioning isn't a luxury but a necessity. Each of those different requirements varies depending on circumstance and need. There are plenty more variables: fuel, distance, cost, and the deeper you dig, the more choices. Antennas are no different. While cars have an element of fashion, colour, styling, etc., antennas are more utilitarian. Radio amateurs rarely care about the colour of their contraption, but they do care about cost, construction, and performance. Those three variables alone would make for plenty of choice, but we've not yet talked about some other variables that come into play. If you're a licensed amateur, picking the frequency you want to use is obvious and a major factor in the choice of antenna. But if you're not an amateur, that's not something obvious, but you have seen it before. Without going into the physics of how and why, imagine all the antennas you've seen in your life. There's a TV antenna on the roof, the antenna on a transistor radio, an antenna on a car, the antenna on your Wi-Fi modem, a mobile phone antenna, satellite dishes. You might have seen antennas near train lines, on top of traffic lights, on a GPS, and on a satellite phone. You might not be familiar with all of them, but enough to know that there is a huge range of different types of antennas. The more you look, the more variation you find. You might think that each of those different antennas was chosen at the whim of the person spending the money. But actually, each of those antennas was chosen for a specific job. Each of those antennas works on at least one frequency, sometimes more, and does so taking into account its purpose. Is the antenna for sending, or receiving, or both? Is it supposed to work regardless of where it's installed, or how high off the ground it is? Does it need to take into account interference from a particular direction? Is it meant for strong or weak signals? Does it need to have a defined lifespan, deal with a particular wind strength, etc., etc.? Answering each of those questions determines the choices made to select an antenna from the infinite variety available. As an amateur, my license allows me to operate in 6 different frequency ranges or bands. Technically, that means at least 6 different antennas, just so I can use the frequencies I'm licensed for. Of course, I'm only scratching the surface here, since I've already explained that antennas come in many different shapes and sizes, each with different characteristics and trade-offs. So next time you wonder why so many different antennas, that's why. If you've been wondering when I'll answer the bit about the best antenna, you should already have a clue by now. But the real answer is, unsurprisingly, that depends. On what, you ask? On whichever variables you care about, and to which degree. The best antenna depends on the questions you ask. Ask better questions, get a better antenna. I'm Ono, Victor Kilo 6, Foxtrot Lima Alpha Bravo.
Daily Minutes zijn dagelijks vanaf ongeveer 1900 uur te beluisteren. De uitzending wordt een dag later om 10:30 ochtends herhaald. Alle mail is welkom op het adres x@xdv.me. Dat is ook te vinden rechts bovenaan de webpagina van de uitzending, www.pa0ete.nl. De Daily Minutes toont iedere dag weer aan de hand van schokkende voorbeelden hoe een hobby mensenlevens kan veranderen. De internetfaciliteiten en studiohardware voor Daily Minutes worden gesponsord door 70MHzShop.nl. 70MHzShop.nl.
En microfoon naar retour.